Welcome to, thank you for joining us once again, especially those of you who are with us this morning. We now have our community conversation, Action Pathways and Shared Abundance, where we're going to dive deeper into what Dave discussed during the kickoff session this morning. My name is Barb Thies, and I am the Director of Community Engagement here at the OEN. We're so happy to have you all here today, and we thank you for the work that each of you in our community do to make education more equitable, accessible, and affordable through open education. Before we begin, the OEN is housed at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities, which is located on traditional, ancestral, and contemporary lands of Indigenous people. The university resides on Dakota land ceded in the treaties of 1837 and 1851. We acknowledge this place has a complex and layered history. This land acknowledgement is one of the ways in which we work to educate the campus and community about this land and our relationships with it and each other. We are committed to ongoing efforts to recognize, support, and advocate for American Indian nations and peoples. And we invite you to think about and acknowledge the Indigenous people to whom the land you are situated on belongs in the chat, if you feel so inclined. As we begin the session, we'd like to share a few important logistical details with you. This session will be recorded up until the point where we, Dave's going to do a little intro, and then we'll divide up into breakout rooms, at which point we'll stop recording so that you all feel comfortable sharing in the breakouts. For that reason, you've been muted for now. The video of the first part of the session, transcripts and slides, I don't actually think we have slides for this one, so I take that back. The documents that we'll be sharing with you will be sent out after the summit and also sent out in the Google group and posted to the community hub so that you have access to those. When we're in breakout rooms, we'll kind of circle back on this once again, but we are going to ask you to keep it to the chat while we're all in this room together, because we're kind of a large group at 55. And then once we're in the breakout rooms, you can certainly comment in the chat or unmute yourself to add any comments that you have during that part of the conversation. We are committed to providing a friendly, safe, and welcoming environment for all summit attendees. You can learn more about our community norms at z.umn.edu/summit-community-norms, which has just been shared in the chat. And the hashtag for the summit is #OENSummit22. You can join us on Twitter at @OpenEd_network. And now over to our executive director, Dave Ernst, who will take it from here.
Great. Thank you, Barb. Hello, everybody, and welcome to this community conversation. We're really excited for this. I think we're going to be generating lots of interesting ideas, and that's what we hope, at least. And we thank you for being part of that. If you wouldn't mind, would you mind putting in the chat your name, your institution, and then your favorite movie? And that might get people to actually look at it. And I'd just like to see who's here, and let you see who's here. And then we'll get going here. I'll let that run as I talk. So today we're going to discuss action pathways. These are programs that we've developed in our strategic planning process. We're calling them action pathways. Don't worry if you haven't heard that before. I'm going to go over those in just a second, see what they are. And shared abundance. I'll also talk about what that is here in a second, but shared abundance basically means it's one of our core principles, means that we believe that we have the tools that it takes to solve larger problems together. So thank you to those who are putting your names in there. I'm looking for movies. Very good. So we actually do have some slides here, Barb. I'm going to kind of briefly if you weren't there this morning, I want to reiterate some of the things that we talked about this morning in the kickoff session and just remind you what we're talking about here. So hold on just a second. So we're going to be talking about our action pathways. So really, really briefly, This is a summary of some core programming that we both do and plan to do. The middle two columns are new programs where we want to be supporting your open pedagogy work, and we want to be supporting your OER revision and OER collection work. And so we've also added some really important pieces in adding some infrastructure that we're recommending, that we're thinking of adding, Pressbooks, manifold editors, so and or do more full support of those platforms for our community, and then also hiring some support to make sure that your work in this is fully supported. Someone who can tie together, for instance, open pedagogy and manifold, for instance, as a platform, and help you help your instructors learn how to do open pedagogy using that platform. So again, the usual kind of on the ground work that we do at the OEN, helping you get that done. You'll notice there's a row on the bottom called shared, that we've titled shared abundance. I'll talk about that in a bit, but the shared abundance is actually one of our guiding principles that was developed a few years ago by the community. These are our guiding principles. And so when we went through our strategic planning processes last year, we kept these in the foreground. And shared abundance is one that came up quite often. And I think you'll see why here in a second. So again, as Barb mentioned, this is what we're all aiming at, right? Educational equity, using open education, whatever your focus is, it may be different than the person next to you. There may be you may be focused on affordability. Someone else may be focused on bringing student voices and diverse voices into academic materials, but it's about education. It's all boils down to that. That's what we're looking for. Our hope is that as large as our network is, here's our network right now, most recent numbers, it's large. There's a lot of people working on this and working together. We really think that that concept of shared abundance really can come into play here, because I'm sorry if you saw this morning, but I'm going to repeat it just for the sake of teeing us off here. If this is a representation of the OEN, these are each institutions, we have so many different institutions in the OEN. We have large and small and public and private and research and community college, technical college, tribal college, HBCU, so on. If this represents that, the services that we provide in OEN are going to these institutions, right? These are the institutions that are members of the OEN. We just want to keep in mind that there are institutions out there beyond our membership that don't maybe have the kind of funding or staffing that many of our member institutions might have. They might have one librarian in the whole school and no budget. The faculty of these institutions might never even hear about open education, right? There's no one there to kind of spread the news. So they won't be able to get significant support or professional development or funding for projects or anything like that. So this is a generalization, of course. It's not like, everyone in the OEN is set and everyone outside the OEN is not. There are many members within the OEN who also are very limited resources, budget, time, all of those kinds of things, of course. In fact, I'll bet many of you are going, yep, that's me. And there are institutions outside the OEN, certainly, that are really well off and well funded. So it's a generalization, but we want to keep in mind the fact we know that OEN members have at least a person, right? I mean, they have a contact person. There's someone who's there's a budget to at least pay the OEN membership, the community fees. So what we want to do is just make sure that we're not widening the gap between these groups of institutions. Open education is just a tool. And if the tool is applied broadly and kind of evenly, then it'll benefit everybody. But if it's really only being applied to those who already have resources, then we're really just widening the gap. And so when our team went through our strategic planning process, we kept asking the question, like, are there ways that we can support these institutions, the broader collection of institutions and their faculty? So we're not widening that gap between the haves and have-nots. And again, all of our institutions have subsets of students who aren't well represented in course materials, or perhaps whose perspectives and voices are ignored. And so we know that there are opportunities in open education to address some of these things. So again, we don't want to apply them just to the colored group of institutions there in the middle. We want to make sure we're not widening the gap. So again, our team asked the question, are there ways that we can kind of support a balancing of representation and perspectives and course materials across all institutions? So that's where shared abundance comes into play. It's pretty slim chance that the small team of OEN staff can change every institution or support every institution in the country or in the world, right? And so that isn't going to happen, but we still want to keep that need in front of us. The fact that there are, that we don't want to widen the gap. So the hope is this, the hope is that we can lean on our principle of shared abundance and hope that perhaps that collectively, we have some tools we can throw at that problem of not leaving some behind. So that's what today is about. Today is, you notice that row is blank. There's nothing there. And that's because we're really hoping that you as a community can help brainstorm some ideas where we collectively can come up with some solutions, some ideas about how to address this. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna focus on these questions today. So how can we as a community of open ed professionals support the open education initiatives of those institutions who have limited access to resources, whether they're members or not, right? Limited resources means they can't do much. How can we support faculty who want to publish or edit or adopt or collect or OER at less resource institutions? So how do you support faculty who don't have those resources locally? How can we as a community leverage open education to bring more voices into academia, including student voices? Bringing student voices is one way to bring representation into academia, right? So those are the four questions that we're going to be talking about today, that we're going to be trying to brainstorm around. And we're going to do that by breaking up into some small groups, one for each of these pathways. Oops, there we go, right? One for OER adoptions, one for pedagogy, revision and collection, and textbook publishing. I think OER adoptions, let me just give you a brief summary so you can decide which one to choose. OER adoptions is about faculty deciding to use OER in their course. Open pedagogy is efforts to change instructors' pedagogy to use OER to bring student voices into the academic material. Open OER revision and collection is the most squishy of these four, I think, where there's two things here. There's revision, so editing, whether that's bringing other voices into academic materials or bringing contextual localized information in there or just editing it to make it fit your course better. Collection is something that we're approaching as a kind of a simpler way to publish rather than the last column, which is open textbook publishing, which many of you are involved with. That's a pretty big lift of publishing a textbook. A collection, it would be creating a meaningful collection of OER that suits the needs of one particular course or courses. So just gathering things together that make sense for the instructor. So those are briefly what they mean. So OER adoption action pathway, OER pedagogy, revision and collection, and open textbook publishing. So you can see that one of the OEN staff will be in each of the small group rooms and just help prompt you a little bit to think about these things. Barb is going to stay back in the main room here. If you get into one room and perhaps you actually maybe I want to go over to the open pedagogy room instead, feel free to just when you're in the breakout room, click the leave room button. You'll be dropped back into the larger room where you can go back and either Barb will assign you or you can just choose you can just choose a different room and participate in that one. This is brainstorming. So the more ideas, the better. So try to refrain from judgment. Try to refrain from putting up walls or barriers and saying, no, that's, you can't do that, or we're not going to be able to do it. This is just brainstorming, throwing ideas out there. And then we will record all of this and bring this back and have discussions about how to move forward with the community as we go. So, all right. I'm going to open the room. Barb, am I missing anything here? Let's see.
The only other thing is that if your breakout room session conversation kind of organically wraps up, we're not going to circle back here and you are free to just go and enjoy the rest of your afternoon, and we'll see you back at the summit tomorrow.
Great. All right. Thank you. So the rooms have been opened. So they are named in a way that makes sense, hopefully, to you. Feel free to join those rooms and we'll see you there.
Yep, have a good rest of your day.